Good evening.
Good evening.
Is this New York?
Yes.
It is? Is Glen Falls?
Yeah.
Solomon Northup. Excuse me for introducing myself. Solomon Northup. I'm from Fort Edward. Back in my day, it was called Sandy Hill. Solomon Northup, you know, the fiddler. Fiddled all in Saratoga. All around here, just about every bar dance that was around, I'd play. And they say you couldn't have a party unless I was playing. I was kind of like the Michael Jackson of my time. Y'all don't know me. Well, I've been away. I've been away for a while, quite a while, 12 years. Yeah, 12 years I've been gone. And I want to say it wasn't my own doing. Maybe it was. It was up to a point, you see. I'm serious. I was a great fiddler. And I played everywhere. You see, I fiddled my whole life. Ever since I was a wee one, I've been a fiddler. My father insisted upon it. Insisted upon going to school and fiddling. First, I didn't like it, but after a while, I come to love it. This fiddle's been my pride and my damnation. I don't know whether to hug it. I don't know where to begin. I'll tell you what happened to me. Well, I was born in 1808. Yeah, maybe it was 1806. Get those circles and ones. Back in the day with handwriting was so messy, couldn't tell. But it was a strange time in America. Yeah, it was a very strange time indeed. Because you see, America was well enthralled in slavery. Slavery. And slavery back then doesn't have the same connotations as slavery has today. No, slavery back then was... Now, don't get all up in arms. What do you mean, necessary? Well, you gotta remember, back then, there was no machines. Everything was made by hand. I mean everything, from the shoes on your feet to the hat on your head. Everything was made by hand. And well, you know, as wonderful a man as you may be, you can't do but so much with two hands. So you need a partner, somebody to help you out. Now you can double your output of whatever you're making. Get two friends or two helpers, now you can triple your output. And when it comes to slaves, you ain't got to pay them. And as Donald Trump would say, that's all profit. Now I'm looking at this audience here, and you're from Glens Falls, so I know you're Yankees. Oh, nothing against you Red Sox fans, but you Yankees. Yup, and Yankees are a strange breed of people. They're only found in the Northeast America. Yup. Yankees, they got... Like most tribes, like most groups of people, have certain behavioral characteristics, certain beliefs. And one of the beliefs of Yankees is, man shall live by the sweat of his brow. Not the sweat of his neighbor's brow, not the sweat of his slave's brow, but man shall live by the sweat of his brow. That's why slavery never took off really big in the Northeast. Just didn't fit into our way of thinking. Now, I'm black, and I'm an American, but I was born in New York, born in Minerva, Essex County, not that far north of here. Spent my whole life in New York. Got to think like a Yankee. I mean, all around me was Yankees. I was a Yankee. Skin color and all, I was a Yankee. Went to school with Yankees. Because you see, New York didn't segregate its schools back in then. No. No, if you were eligible and if your daddy let you go, you went to school. Yeah, you could go to school. Didn't matter if you was the only black child in the school or not. And me and my brother, we was the only black children in the school. Now, normally, that would cause me to be a blues singer. But I had a fiddle. I had a fiddle and everybody. Let's see somebody back there tapping their foot. Everybody likes to dance. And I gotta say, it helped my popularity in school immensely. Come on, Solomon, play a tune for us. And I would. Anything to keep from doing homework. You didn't hear that from me, young man. But yeah, the fiddle was, well, it was my escape. I spent hours on it. I certainly did. Now, as a Yankee, Yankees gotta be skilled. Yeah, we skilled people. Because we got four seasons. Four seasons. And every season, there's something to do. Every season, we got some work. Yeah, summertime, well, summertime's probably the nicest time, right? But spring, you got planting, fall, you got harvesting. What do you do in the winter? Well, winter up here, we got lumbering. Yeah, we got lumbering, we got ice. There's always something to do. You gotta do something. Now, this time, I'm saying there's no machines. Well, there's also no social service agencies. No welfare, no social security. So if you ain't working, you ain't eating. Simple as that. And men, oh men, you didn't know what it was to be a man unless you could work hard. Yeah, we didn't have no baseball, basketball, football, hockey. No, no, no. Man made his reputation by how hard he could work. Girls looked at him because he could provide for their family. That's what made the women look at you. Not because you could make a hoop. No. And Yankees, they got a lot of pride in their work. Yeah, we name ourselves after our work. Right? Taylor, Cooper. That's, you're known by what you do. And I was a hard-working Yankee. Oh, I did it all. See, up here, too, was a huge boom. The Industrial Revolution was coming. And there was work to be had. There was work on the canal. Yep, the canal over. That Whitehall Canal, the Champlain Canal, there was work on that. There was lumbering to be done and farming. You see, I was raised as a farmer. Mm-hmm. And actually, 80% of America back then was raised as farmers. Yeah, there was no Stewart's or Hannaford or Price Chopper. No, if you didn't grow it, you didn't eat it. So everybody was into farming. And my daddy, he was into farming. Now, I say I was born in New York. It means I was born free. It was 1808. Granted, New York didn't get rid of slavery till 1825, 1827. But I was a free man. I was born free because my parents were free. Well, now, my daddy, he was a slave. Slave to Captain North out of Rhode Island. Now, it's not widely known. But Rhode Island was a hotbed of Quakers. I know everybody's thinking, oh, I thought that was Pennsylvania. Yeah, it was Pennsylvania. But it was Rhode Island, too. And Captain Northup, well, he was a seagoing man. Yep, decided to give up his life at sea and wanted to get in the farm. Broke my daddy with it. And upon his death, he left in his will for my father to be free. And he was. He was good to his word. My father lived the remainder of his days as a free man. Raised up me and my brother as free children. See, my daddy was married. His wife, my mama, she was half black, half Indian. Now, a lot of people don't think about black Indians. Oh no, everybody can readily recognize and even adopt them blue-eyed Indians. Them woolly-haired Indians, everybody? No, ain't no such thing as woolly-haired Indians. But yeah, you gotta remember, what would make an Indian want to marry a black man? Oh my God, what's wrong with them people? Well, the first slaves in America were Indians. Yeah, nobody recognizes that. The first slaves were Indians, people of the forest, Hiawatha and his people. The first slaves in America, but you know, like anybody in there, right? They didn't want to be slave, well, no more than you. Because you was the second big group of slaves in America. Oh yeah, white folks, just like you. Mm-hmm. But Indians, oh, this was their home. Ain't gonna have to be a slave in your own house. That's not gonna happen. No, in your own house, you know where good hiding spots are. Ain't gonna put them children there. Right? Don't y'all know where the good hiding spots are in the house? No, you know where the knives are. Mm-hmm. Indians didn't make good slaves at all. And the white people that came over as slaves, well, they didn't want to be slaves either, no more than Indians. But what they had going for them was appearance. I ain't the slave, must be him. No, not me, it's got to be him. Couldn't tell who was a slave owner and who was a slave. Oh, that woolly-haired, black-skinned African don't look like anybody. So be he slave or be he free, we'll just treat them all like slaves. Sure, and unlike the Indians, they don't know what trees will feed them. They don't know. They don't even know that the rivers don't have alligators and crocodiles. Oh, and coal? A totally foreign concept to the African. He's going to be dependent on his slave owner just to keep warm. And in the time of the world where there's no machines, what better machine can you have than another human being? Help me. Y'all got jobs? No? I know you got chores. You got homework. Yeah? Tell me you ain't got no homework. You got homework? Imagine if you will. You got somebody to do all your chores. Somebody to do all your work. Somebody to do all your homework. Sounds pretty good, don't it? Oh, yes it does. You know it sounds good. And it was good. It was good like that for 400 years. 400 years, somebody did all our work, all our homework, all of our chores, and we didn't have to give them nothing. Not even a thank you, not even a chip off your chocolate chip cookie. You ain't got to give them the crumbs or nothing. It's all for you. It's a good life. Yeah. The only bad part is if you're the one doing it all. And like you kids always say, and it's true, that just ain't fair. It ain't fair. You're right, it ain't fair. And when you tell that to mom and dad, what do they say back to you?
My life ain't fair.
Dad, you're so weak. But it's true. Yeah, that's not an alternative fact. That's a fact, Dad. It just ain't fair. 1808, year I was born. Well, not long before that, the nation did away with the slave trade out of Africa. No more Africans coming to America.
Well, that's what the law said.
Yep, no more slaves coming out of Africa. Too many slave rebellions.
Oh, yeah, slave rebellions.
Them ungrateful slaves was taking heads, going for freedom. Well, after all, they've been free people in Africa. You know, our founding fathers, the great men that they are, they said, you know, we'll abolish that slave trade. That's why these people going crazy. They know freedom. We'll breed our own. Like a puppy mill. Yeah, we'll raise them up in slavery. They won't know freedom, so they therefore won't have a thirst for it. Virginia, Maryland, North Carolina all became slave breeding states. Slave breeding states. Because you see, at that same time, there was this guy, a hero to America, named Eli Whitney. He had invented a cotton gin. The cotton gin. What the cotton gin did was it took the seeds out of cotton. This cotton's got these little seeds in them. They're about as big as an apple seed. But you can't spin this cotton into bread with them lumpy, bumpy, hard seeds in there. No, you can't. Because you see, what makes cotton such a magnificent plant is that you can take it and make thread out of it just by twisting. Just by twisting it, it becomes thread. A good thread, too. Yes. It's the way we live. Cotton. And it truly is. I challenge anybody here not to be wearing something cotton. We're all wearing cotton. Cotton is a wonderful thing. But now that Eli Whitney can take these seeds out of cotton, we can now spin it much quicker. Right? There's a big demand for cotton. So I like to say what Eli should have invented was a cotton picking machine. Because now that we could spin more, we had to pick more. And slaves weren't needed now to be carpenters. Old slaves weren't needed to be lumbermen or handymen. No, no. We got the Irish for that. We're getting Germans for that. We want you to pick cotton all day long. And they like using slaves for cotton because they say people in the heat. That's when this plant is ready for harvest in the heat when it's hot. You can see it's all dried out. It's all dried out. It's kind of like, I know you're from New York, you don't know nothing about cotton. Well, it's kind of like milkweed. Mm-hmm. I know you know milkweed. It's a beautiful plant, pretty as milkweed. Actually, it even has the same little hard crust, but when the milkweed pops out, that little fluff comes out. Yeah, it's got the same thing. Yeah. Except instead of the little, this is a bit more dense. This is so dense. I say you can make a shirt out of it. Pants. Everything. Even sneakers. Everything is made from cotton. Well, now they need more slaves to pick cotton. No slaves coming in from Africa. And I guess those slaves in North Carolina and Maryland were working hard to produce their own. But it still wasn't enough. So there became a huge trade in stealing people. Stealing free people. Just up and stole me. Well, I shouldn't say they just up and stole me, no, because I'm a man. I'm a man. I ain't no little kid. I'm a man. I got a wife and three kids. They got to me. I was playing in these fancy hotels. Oh, you know how Saratoga is. Grand Union, the American, big fancy hotels. No more barn dances here in Glens Falls.
Fort Edward. No. I'd moved up to big time. You see, my wife. My wife, man. Now, she was a black woman, and she was a cook. But she was no mammy cook. Oh, no. In these fancy hotels, she had 14 people working under her. Yeah, she was a big-time chef. Man, if they had TV back then, I know she'd be on the food channel. Yeah, Ann said to me, you know, Solomon, all winter long, if you ain't playing the fiddle, you're doing lumbering. That's hard work. Fiddling's a lot easier. She said, you know, instead of playing these little barn dances, you should be doing the big hotels. Before I knew it, there I was doing big fancy hotels. I was making great money. And in the wintertime, that's wonderful. And in the springtime, that's great too. And it was in the springtime, after one of my performances, I was approached by these two gentlemen. Two men. Yeah, Mr. Merrill. Well-dressed men, seemed like gentlemen. They loved the way I played. They told me I played real fine. Thanks. I thought so myself. And they said, you know, we got a circus in New York City. New York City, you should come with us to the circus. Play for us down in our circus. We'll pay you some of that New York City money. New York City money. Yeah, this very weekend. Wow. New York City, man. I ain't never been to New York. Now, I've been all around. Been up to Montreal, Queensbury. I've been all around. Down in Detroit. I've been everywhere. I mean, my work on the canal took me a lot of places. And, you know, taking my farm goods out to market, that took me places, too. But I ain't never been to New York City. Y'all been to New York City? I said, yes, and well, I hadn't been. So I was kind of intrigued by it. Wow. I said, well, you know, I'll go, but I got to call my wife and let her know that you guys are talking about leaving right now. Oh, there's no phones. Couldn't exactly call her. I'll leave a note. Now, you married me. Don't you try this at home. Honey, I'm going to New York City for the weekend. I'll be back Monday. Left it a note. And off I went with my two new friends, Mr. Merrill and Mr. Brown. Oh, man, what a time we had, too. Took a stagecoach down, took a boat down. I mean, I took all forms of transportation, all forms known back then. It was a big adventure. When we got to New York City, they took me right to the circus. Saddest circus I ever seen in my life. No wonder they wanted me to play for them. They didn't have, it was a dog and pony show, but they didn't even have a pony. It was the saddest thing, and I played my heart out. And I gotta say, true to their word, they filled my pockets with money. Yes, indeed, I got some of that New York City money, and I was happy as could be. Well, Mr. Hamilton, Mr. Brown, thank you very much. Got my New York City money. I'm heading home. Whoa, wait a minute. Wait a minute, Solomon. You know, we also have interests in Washington, D.C. The nation's capital. And President Harris and him just passed. It's going to be big doings in Washington. You should come on down to Washington with us and make even more money. More money? More money. How could I say no? So sure enough, I went on down to Washington with my newfound friends. Oh, man, what a time it was in Washington, D.C. There was parties everywhere. And to celebrate our new business dealings, Mr. Hamilton and Mr. Brown offered me a drink. Now, I ain't a teetotaler, man. I say, I'm from Fort Edward, not from Argyle. So I figured I could partake in just a little sip. Now,
might remember if it was one sip or two.
Could have been three. But what I do remember is being powerfully sick. I hadn't been that sick in recent years. I hadn't been that sick since I was a child. I was sick. I was so sick, I could only get solace in darkness. So I closed my eyes, and then I realized I was too far off the ground. I had to get low. I mean, my stomach was going in and out. I think maybe 8 rocks or... Now, I don't know if I fell asleep, if I passed out, but I thought I just closed my eyes for a minute. When I came to, my mouth felt like it was full of cotton. My head was heavy as lead. Oh, I was so sick. And again, I just thought I could find some relief in darkness and in sleep. I wanna come to. Oh, I had come to a few times. I thought this time was for real. I was really awake. I wasn't quite sure because I opened my eyes and it was still dark. Hello? There's no one there. I started to lift my arms. My arms were as heavy as my head. I realized why. I was chained. Oh. I was chained. Around my neck. An iron dog cuff around my hands, around my feet, to the wall. What? Is this a case of mistaken identity? Hello? Somebody out there? I'm no criminal, I'm a musician. Somebody out there just help? Help! Help. Maybe it's part of my sickness, because I still wasn't right. I lapsed in and out of darkness. And every time I came out of it, these still had my hands. This was still around my neck. I was still chained to the wall. Finally, there was a crack of light. I could see a door opposite to where I was. A door. Hello, can you help me? I saw the figures of two men entering. So finally, someone come, heard my pleas. Come and help me. I don't know what happened here. They drew nearer. So I tried to explain my situation to my... Oh! They hit me with a bat. They hit me with this big paddle. Wait. I'm no criminal. Oh! Every time I tried to explain who I was, I got struck. Every time I tried to identify myself, I was struck. Now, I ain't the sharpest knife in the drawer, but that beating like that, it didn't take me long to realize. Only time I wasn't hit is if I didn't say anything. So I didn't say anything. I could see through that light in the door. I could see the nation's capital. I was in Washington, D.C., all right. I was in the slave pens. Now, I knew about slavery. Oh, yeah, I knew about slavery. Yeah, I'm a Yankee boy. But I lived in and played in Saratoga Springs. And Saratoga, you know, was a known resort back then. And especially in the summertime, well, that's where all the Southerners came to escape the heat. And when they came, they brought slaves with them. And I would see these brothers of my skin, give them a nod, how you do? And even encourage some to seek their freedom. I mean, after all, Saratoga's right next door to Quaker Springs. You know how them Quakers are. Yeah, they may be peaceful people, but they are warriors when it comes to human rights. At 12 years, I was in bondage. 12 years. And all during that time, I'm plotting and praying and planning. How do I get out of this situation? But everything down there, everything in the South was based on keeping you in slavery. I'm not going to go through 12 years of torture, humiliation, and horror that befell me. No, there's a movie out for that. But I want you to know that after 12 years, I did regain my freedom. I regained my freedom because of my friends. Henry B. Northup, to be specific. You see, Henry B. and I, well, there's only 2 years between us. And the reason we share the same name, because my father took the Northup name from Captain Northup. Henry B. was like Captain Northup's great nephew. We went to school together, me and Henry B. We fished the Hudson River, Baton Kill, and any other water source that had fish, we did it together. Now, though I was a big brother, Henry B. was like my big brother. In 1851, Henry B. came south to get me. It took that long for me to get word to my family where I had been. Now I know you're thinking, well, you've been to school, why don't you just write for help? Couldn't call, because you know there was no phones. Well, in the South, blacks weren't allowed to read and write. No, if you could write, they'd cut off your fingers. Kind of like my fingers. You could read, it would burn out your eyes. As long as you can read and write, as long as you can learn, you can never be a slave. I know you're saying, well, what happened to you? 12 years of agony, 12 years of wondering how my wife and children were doing? You know, the life expectancy for a slave in the South is 7 years. 7 years, I did 12. Because all along, I knew I had to live. I did everything I could to live. You know, They don't feed you much in slavery. I remember right. 5 pounds of cornmeal, pound of bacon, that'd be your ration for a month. Rancid bacon and cornmeal. You know I didn't get this figure on that. I invented me a fish trap. Yep, I invented a fish trap. So when I was working in the fields, that fish trap was enhancing my diet. Yankee ingenuity, they call it. Yeah, because I'm a Yankee. Now I say, I regained my freedom after 12 years, and that should be the end of a happy story, right? Wasn't meant to be. No, wasn't meant to be. After 12 years, I reunited with my family, and I can't begin to tell you the joy I felt. And the sorrow. Because you see, Elizabeth, my oldest daughter, she had gotten married. I wasn't there to walk her down the aisle. She had a little boy, too. Named him after me. Named him Solomon. But I wasn't there. I missed that. Little Alfonso, my pride and joy, I just couldn't wait to hug that child. Well, he wasn't 6 anymore. No, 12 years, he's 18, he's a man. He was a man. And I know we're not supposed to be disappointed in our children, but he told me he was unemployable. My son, unemployable? How can that be? How could my child be unemployable? Well, there was nobody there to teach him how to handle a team of horses. There was nobody there to show him how to fall a tree and turn that tree into furniture and lumber. And my wife, Ann, what a woman. What a woman. For those 12 years, she kept those kids fed, kept them educated. And she did it without me. She didn't need me anymore. And though we had a grand reunion, 3 months, we were no longer living as man and wife. I never went back to Saratoga. No, I know they have an annual party for me there now. That's where I got kidnapped from. I went on to Vermont. Vermont began strenuous work on the Underground Railroad. Sorry, I'm leaving you all with not a happy ending, but as you told your children, that's life. Life ain't fair. I'm truly sorry I've not entertained you properly. Perhaps I can make it up by entertaining some questions you may have about my life and times. They haven't found my grave they haven't found any signs of my death because I'm here with you. And I don't plan on going anywhere anytime soon as long as there's depression. As long as there's oppression, I mean, injustice done anywhere is injustice done everywhere. Injustice done to you is injustice done to me. And as a citizen not only of America, but as a citizen of planet Earth, right. I owe it to you, to my neighbors, to call it out, to stop it if I can, to do what I can, to fight for it. So no, you ain't found no graves for me, no sign of my death, because I ain't dead. I did write a book, and I gotta say, that book is still in print. I cannot believe it. That, you know, at the time, I had to do a little bragging. At the time it was written, it was second only to Harriet Beecher Stowe's Uncle Tom's Cabin. It was a bestseller. And yeah, it, you know, I say I don't know much about slavery, just my experience and the experience of those around me. Because I heard so many stories, so many, I think of how horrible it was for me. It were those who were left in such, were in such worse condition than I. You know, after my 12 years, I had a home to go to. I had, and all the time I was in, I was thinking of that home. Thinking of how I gotta get out of here. I gotta get out of this situation. And, you know, a lot of people say to me about that book, too. Well, you know, how could you remember all of those details? Well, I'll tell you how I can remember. Because every day, every night that I went to bed, I went over that day and went over the day before, and I kept wondering, how in the world did this happen to me? I still wonder. Damn Yankees. You know, Yankees, I can't think enough about Yankees. You know, you think, why were Yankees kind of hesitant about slavery? I mean, think about it. I'll be honest with you. I'd like to have a slave myself. But, you know, think of all the work I got to do. Yeah, that'd be nice to have a slave. Why was Yankees so against it? Well, it was against their religion. They were Christians. And I don't mean this one day a week, once a week going to church. No, this was in their life. You know, the Bible. There's no TV, no radio, very few newspapers, no magazines, no distractions. And the Bible was everything. The Bible was your textbook. The Bible was your religious leanings. It was your entertainment. It was your comic book. It was your children's stories. We think of children, think of Noah's Ark. Oh, what a beautiful children's story. Oh, David and Goliath. Oh, the children have to know that stuff. Those are Bible stories. Those are Bible stories. All of those stories have a message. And the end of that message is always to love thy neighbor as thyself. The message is what you do to the least of them, you do to me. I mean, how many times can you read it? Because you did read it. That's how you learned to read. And after you learned to read, you taught your sister how to read out of it. So you're reading these same stories over and over and over again. That damn Yankee started believing it. Think about it. They believed it. I'm looking at Joe here because he's a historian. He knows. Joe, you know who's the poorest president we ever had?
Oh, dear.
The Adams. The Adams, poorest presidents. Why? They didn't have no slaves. Everybody before Lincoln had a slave, but not the Adams. They were Yankees. Man shall live by the sweat of his brow. Yeah, that's going to make you poor. But your reward's going to come later. They believed it. Now, one of my big heroes, not in my lifetime, but it's John Brown. love John Brown. Right? How do we see John Brown today? Bible in one hand,
gun in the other.
Right. John Brown, he said, he, you know, people they today they call him the father of American terrorism. Because he killed people. He said, if you was a slave owner, you'd die. And why? Again, you know, we would criminalize him today, but we got to think back then. Back then. Back then, he was righteous. Back then, there wasn't a cop on every corner. No, no. Law enforcement was damn near nil. John Brown said, if a fox went in your hen house, what would you do? You'd shoot it. So if these men are stealing other men, I shoot them. You know, as much as I love Yankees, I have to say, prior to 1851, Yankees weren't all abolitionists. No, no, my favorite people weren't. Yankees have another belief. They like to mind their own business. You want to have slaves, it's your business. But in 1851, so many slaves were running away. So many slaves were escaping on that Underground Railroad that it was affecting economies. A senator, my favorite story, the Underground Railroad. There's a lot of different ways how the Underground Railroad got its name, but there was a senator who had a big farm, Southern senator, and he stood up in the House and he said, I got up this morning, all my slaves are gone. Who's gonna harvest my crop? I got 100 people gone. Grandmas and grandpas, babies, they're all gone. How did 100 people disappear from the face of the earth? What did they have, a train? They didn't leave any sick, did it run underground? It's estimated as many as 40,000 people a year were making their way out, were escaping. This was affecting,
now I miss my baby and old Uncle John.
No, this was affecting people's pockets, messing with their money. So they enacted this Fugitive Slave Act. Fugitive Slave Act of 1851, which said you have to help me get my slaves back. You have to. Whether you believe in slavery or not, it's federal law. And you know another thing about Yankees, just like you children, they do not like being told what to do. Yeah, you all laugh because you know it's true. You don't like being told what to do. And Yankees didn't care about slavery one way or another because it wasn't their business. A few Yankees had slaves, I don't care, it ain't my business. But now you're making it my business. You telling me I got a what? I mean, you can see them. You know your grandmas and grandpas. Well, tell me what to do. No, I think I'm gonna go the opposite way. And I think that made more people abolitionists than anything else. Yeah, I'm gonna help these. Just because you wanna try to force something on me, I'm just willing to let you do your business. Now you're making me part of this? And you know, 10 years later, this is Civil War. Boom. And it eradicated it for a while.
Yes.
Actually, most of my descendants are now found in Maryland. Saratoga, and actually last year was Skidmore College. Undertaking upon itself to celebrate the second weekend in July as Solomon Northup weekend. That's always bothered me, because Saratoga is where I got kidnapped from. You know what I mean? Most of my life, most of my home is Fort Edward. But yeah, Saratoga has done this wonderful deed, and actually some years ago, they searched out my family and brought them up from Saratoga, from Maryland.
you know, from that area, with most of, and most of them are descendants of Alonzo, my son, my unemployable son. Now, in his credit, I must say that Alonzo joined the USCT, United States Colored Troops. These were the black troops that fought in the Civil War. And he joined the 54th. The 54th was a very well-known unit. That's what their movie Glory was made of, the 54th. 54th also, other members of the 54th were Frederick Douglass's sons. Frederick Douglass had two sons that were in the 54th. So I like to think that my Alonzo fought alongside him. I'd like to say too, I'm not just talking about my descendants, but I say I was saved. How I got out after 12 years of being a slave, I was literally building an outhouse on a barn, a chicken coop. It's part of this farm. My master realized I couldn't pick cotton. These are lumberjack hands. My fingers are just too big to go in there and pick these out without getting stabbed by the twigs and bleeding on the cotton. It just wasn't working. It wasn't happening. But my master realized I was good with wood. I was a carpenter. So he had put me to work building this barn. And while I was still a slave, so he ain't putting me in charge. He got this man by the name of Bass. Mr. Bass was, well, he was kind of the village idiot. Mr. Bass was from Canada. What a Canadian is doing in Louisiana, he must have been the village idiot. But Mr. Bass was an outspoken abolitionist. Here he is surrounded by all this slavery and all of these slave owners. And he's speaking abolition. They thought he was a joke. Nobody took him serious. They thought he was a buffoon, some fool. They used him for entertainment at parties. Well, he was put in charge of my care because he too was a carpenter. And one day, maybe 12 years, a long time to be away from home. Suicide by cop. I was on that verge. But I said to him, I said, Mr. Bass, would you post a letter for me? I asked him to post a letter. Now I know that sounds like a real simple, easy task. But when I asked that, he said those words I dreaded to hear. You can write? I had already let it out the bag. Yeah. I can write. I can read it too. So he said, sure. I'll be glad to post the letter for you. Better than that, I'll even write the letter. Now, this is 1851. You think the mail is slow today? 1851, every day I go to work, and me and Mr. Bass are working side by side, sawing the wood, hammering the wood. He's whistling and all happy. Did you turn me in? Did you tell him I can read and write? Did you tell him I was from New York? One day, there was literally a crowd at the big house. A crowd, so much it was stirring up dust. It looked like a storm. And it was leaving the big house and it was coming to me. Tell him about me.
And in that crowd, I could see this big top hat, this big man. It could be no other than Henry B. Norton. It could be no other, my childhood friend, Henry B., a Yankee who in 1851, the year John Brown was in all the newspapers, killing slave owners, the scourge of the North, he had the nerve, he had the audacity. Henry B. had the nerve to come south and say, I'm taking this black man home. This black man is not a slave. He is a free man, and he does not belong here. And he brought me. Now, I bring that up because you asked me about my people, my ancestors. Yeah, they're here. They're my ancestors, my descendants. Thank you very much. And you got more gray hair than me. I'm supposed to be dead. You're supposed to forget, not me. But yes, my descendants. The year before last, when Skidmore brought up my descendants from Maryland, they also brought Mr. Bass's descendants from Canada.
Oh.
I'm telling you. I'm tearing up now just thinking about it. It was the most beautiful thing. It really was. It was just beautiful, beautiful. Yeah, second weekend in July, keep your ears to the ground. Skidmore or somewhere around the Solomon Northup Day. And it's usually full of not just scholarship but entertainment. Just love and fun.